Thanks everyone for joining us for this week's weekly investment meeting. Main things I want to touch on is that inflation's likely to remain sticky for some time. That's going to put the Fed in an uncomfortable position, essentially having to tighten and raise interest rates to curb inflation, which at the same time could also hurt growth. We're starting to see this already impact consumers, and I'll show that looking at consumer credit card debt. And when you look at inflation trends in the U.S., investors and consumers still expect inflation to remain elevated. So no improvement on that front. And then lastly, I want to take a look at the energy markets, looking at inventories across the spectrum to highlight that we're in a really sensitive position, meaning that inventories are quite low. So any disruption in supply could make a bad situation even worse. So jumping in here, what we're looking at is the overnight index swap curve, which is starting to invert. You can see that it basically flattens. The high point is roughly around 2 years. The two-year rate comes in at 2.016. You look out a little bit further, you can see the three-year at around 2.12, which is higher than the five-year, which is higher than if you look at the 30-year. The 30-year is just almost falling below 2%. There's a couple of investment banks that I'm seeing starting to like the long end of the yield curve, mainly that while even they think inflation will remain high, they think that the high inflation rate plus central bank tightening will start to curb growth, and we could see long-term interest rates fall and have a further inversion. So that is something we are starting to see here, whether you're looking at the US Treasury curve or the overnight index swap curve, we are starting to see somewhat of an inverted curve, just slightly, but definitely something to keep track of. Partly why I feel inflation is going to be remaining high for some time. Here, what we're looking at is the UN Food and Agricultural World Food Price Index. And while it's moderated from nearly a 40% annual growth rate, it's still at 20% plus. So year over year, food prices are still rising on an aggregate basis at over 20%. So until we see that really start to move closer to zero, I think we're going to see food inflation trickle into headline inflation for the foreseeable future, particularly in light of the Russian invasion of Ukraine, which has really disrupted the wheat markets globally. Here, what we're looking at is consumer inflation expectations. One-year inflation expectations are over 5.6. Three-year inflation expectations are over 4%. So the problem is if we start to see embedded inflation expectations, consumers start to pull their spending forward to get ahead of inflation and to curb costs. And that could get into the mindset and really create a tough job for the Fed if inflation expectations become anchored. And that is starting to appear to be the case. When you look at this, there's no sign of a reversal in either one-year or three-year inflation expectations. And then next, what we're looking at here is essentially the three-month annualized growth rate in credit card debt outstanding, which is pretty amazing. If you look at where we are, we're roughly 20% higher than year-over-ago levels. So to me, I think a lot of that has to do, if you look at it, it really started to spike late last year into this year, and that correlates with oil prices and gasoline prices, as well as food starting to spike. So I think as government stimulus payments begin to fall off, we're starting to see the consumer tap their credit cards to pay for the increased spending. Next, I wanted to highlight that we're really in kind of a rare situation where we have falling economic activity, which is shown here in the top panel in black with the ISM Manufacturing Index. When you look at global money supply in blue, that is also falling. And at the same time, we have the Federal Reserve, which is raising rates, which is shown in red. So falling global activity, falling money supply in a tight Fed makes for a very difficult situation that really kind of earmarked the latter half of 2018 and led to a mini bear market in the fourth quarter of 2018. You look on the far right of this chart, we can see that global money supply peaked in the spring of 21, which is when a lot of things, high flyers like Cathie Wood's ARK investment funds peaked, the average advanced decline lines for the New York Stock Exchange and others peaked around that time. and the ISM index in the US peaked pretty soon after that. I think it was April, May, when we had a peak in the ISM. So we've got falling economic activity, falling money supply. And now on the far right, we can see the first Fed rate hike. So again, this is a significant concern for the markets, where you've got kind of checkbox, checking off all the boxes on the negative side of the ledger. Typically, risk assets do well when money supply is rising, when economic growth is accelerating, and the Fed is accommodative. We've got all three of those now on the opposite side of the ledger. So I think this is definitely a time to be defensive in nature and effectively reduce the risk that you would normally have in an up cycle. We're still in a down cycle in terms of monetary policy, global growth, and money supply. When we look at global money supply, we can see that's shown here in red, a zoomed in region, that too peaked late last year. So what we're looking at with global money supply is global M2, but priced in dollars. So when we look at European money supply priced in dollars, we look at the Bank of Japan, and we look at the Bank of England, and we price all of their money supplies in dollars to get a good sense of dollar liquidity on a global scale, that too is not favorable. What you can see on the far left in late fall to winter of 2019, the Fed started QE again, and that kind of kicked off a global money supply up cycle. And then that was turbocharged after we had COVID hit the scene in 2020. But we started to see a peak in global money supply at roughly, 20 to 25% annual growth that began to moderate. And right now it's at 11% annually, and definitely decelerating. The concern would be, we've heard from the Fed Chairman Powell last week that the Fed is likely to start reducing its balance sheet at a coming meeting. We don't know if that's the next meeting or maybe two meetings from now, but at some point this year, it seems very likely that we're going to see the Fed reduce its balance sheet. We don't quite know the pace of it, whether it's going to be $50, $80, $100 billion a month. But we're already decelerating. And when you have the Federal Reserve start to shrink its balance sheet, that's going to push global money supply growth closer and closer to zero. Again, this was kind of an unfavorable situation that we saw in late 2018 going into 2019. Now, the concern we have in terms of forward inflation is that we have very tight energy inventories here in the US. Now, if you think about the pain the rest of the world is experiencing, they're experiencing significantly higher energy prices than we are in the US because we are such a huge producer of both natural gas, oil, and other energy fuels. And when you look at the US, for example, there is the concern that we could see a further spike in energy prices, even above what we've already seen. For example, looking at heating oil inventories, here what we're looking at is the high, the low, and the average over the last 5 years. In orange is showing current levels. So we are below the lowest level seasonally over the last 5 years. So not a good situation. When we look at natural gas storage levels, again, what we're looking at is the high, the average, and the low over the last 5 years. We're pretty much hugging the low end there. We're a little bit off the lows over the last 5 years. So not an extreme, but again, we're not even close to average. We're well below average levels for this time of year. When we look at gasoline inventories, same story. We are actually hitting new lows for gasoline storage levels. And when you look at the seasonal draws, we get into the summer driving season, typically oil, gasoline inventories kind of trough around the May, and then they start to flatline for the remainder of the year. So there is that concern that we're already below the five-year average, so we could really see a spike in gasoline prices even further than what we're seeing. I believe I read an article over the weekend that the national average for gasoline is over $5 a gallon. That I think is the highest level since 2008. Looking at crude oil inventories, same story. We are hitting a new seasonal five-year low for crude oil inventories. We are below the lowest level seen in the last 5 years. That is obviously a huge concern. Even further, when you look at diesel inventories are also setting a new five-year seasonal low. Diesel is typically used by transportation industries. So think of mail, trucking, and so forth, that they're really going to see a likely further spike in diesel prices that's going to hurt profit margins. So when we look at oil inventories and other energy inventories, we are at or lower than the five-year extreme. So there is significant risk that despite the high energy prices that we have right now, we could see even a further spike in the months ahead. And the concern is that that is going to eat into the disposable personal income for consumers, that they're going to be spending more money on food and energy, less on clothing and other categories of retail, that could see a hit to retail spending ahead. Given the consumer is roughly 70% of the economy, this is a significant risk to the U.S. economy in the months ahead. So definitely a risky environment. And I think definitely it warrants a more cautious stance versus kind of buying, rushing in and buying this recent bottom that we saw in the markets. Thanks everyone for joining us for this week's weekly investment meeting, and we'll keep you posted in the weeks ahead.
That concludes this week's Financial Sense Investment Summary. If you have any questions about any of the topics discussed or about any of our personalized investment services, feel free to give us a call at 888-486-3939 or email us at grow@financialsense.com. Also, listen to our podcast, Financial Sense News Hour. It's on iTunes, Spotify, or on our website at financialsense.com.